the majesty of the Himalayas makes believers out of atheists. When silence collides, who are we to signify? The seasons have changed, my distance shall be gauged.
I'm standing at a height of 4,850 meters above mean sea level. That is probably halfway to Mount Everest. This is the top of the Barlasla Pass, one of the highest amongst the 11 mountain passes traversed this year at the world's highest motorsport battle arena.
As you all know, it's one of the toughest rallies in the world.
It is something, you know, like an addiction.
Terrain is arduous, right? High speeds, high altitude.
From 8,000 to 18,000 feet in a day.
I'm a Fauji. We have leave in the year. We sacrifice our leave to come and do this event.
Yeah, I think you gotta be slightly, you know, off to do this kind of stuff.
We are praying to God just
complete
the rally. Raid is about completing the rally.
Raid, main to aapko pata hai, raid to agar aap finish karenge, bahut badi baat.
Mighty Himalaya, born of the great Pamir, relentless, formidable, and unforgiving. They say when you ascend the Himalayas, it is like entering a hall of lords. You feel humbled in the presence of sheer majesty. Another thing that humbles you is the culture of the Himalayas, something that has resided in the highest reaches of the world for thousands of years. Something as great and awe-inspiring as the Almighty's great sculptures in the company of which it thrives. Something that stays with you long after you descend back to mean sea level.
Now, we've been covering this rally since 2009, and the experiences have been those that will stay with us for the rest of our lives. So this year, we decided to reach back into hallowed antiquity and tell you the story of how this rally began, how it has grown in its 16-year history, and why it draws people year after year, despite testing their limits every single time.
Each raid has its own unique experience, right? No raid is like the other, let's put it that way. Over the last 16 years, every raid I had something to clear about it. We entered Patio Camp, and I just looked at the sky, and I could see a little bit of, you know, cloud, and somewhere the next day, the snow came, right? And by the time the rally came in the evening, we had a decent amount of snowfall. And the snow kept falling through the night, and then me and Vijay were sitting in my room, which is the barracks of the Patio Camp. And at about 10 o'clock at night, we're contemplating, kya karein? Should we go ahead? Should we not? Should the cars go in? Should we not? And then we hear this chan 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 big sound coming, you know. We both rush out of the room, and this big stallion 4x4 army truck coming down Barlasla with huge snow chains on its wheels. He stopped the fellow. He says, Saab, badi mushkil se main nikal ke aaya hoon, par 2 feet barf pad chuki hai. बड़ी गाड़ी बड़ी मुश्किल से निकली, आपकी कोई गाड़ी जा रही पाई?
इट्स वन ऑफ माय टफेस्ट इवेंट्स एंड माय फेवरेट बिकॉज आई लव स्नो एंड वी आर अ टफ टाइम ऑन Barlasla पास एंड पीपल फ्रॉम डाउन इन द प्लेन्स डोंट अंडरस्टैंड द कंडीशंस इन द स्नो. विजिबिलिटी वाज जस्ट अबाउट जीरो एंड देयर वर मोर देन 80 कार्स स्टक ऑन द पास. सो वी हैड टू कन्विंस पीपल टू लीव देयर कार्स एंड देयर बिलोंगिंग्स देयर एंड जस्ट कम विद अस.
होल कार वाज शेकिंग. वी स्टॉप्ड एंड फाउंड दैट इवन आफ्टर स्टॉपिंग द कार वाज रोलिंग. Then we realized it was a quake. When we looked out, the trees were shaking, the electricity poles were shaking, people were running. It was a major quake which lasted for quite some time.
My name is Abhishek Naren Singh. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the North by Northwest special, Times Now's coverage of the 16th Raid to Himalaya. Let the all-terrain rally tire roll.
Number 29. Fear gets into you and forces you to lift off, and the reality kicks in, you know. And yeah, so it took a few minutes after that to get back to shape and say, yeah, let's push it now.
equally harrowing, you know, when you get stuck on a mountain top, when you're at 15,000 feet, you know, don't forget, 15,000 feet in the Himalayas is more than the Alps, right? And I had a German competitor sitting in my car with me, and he narrated his stories of the Alps, and they were nowhere as nearly as harrowing as what he witnessed yesterday in the car with me.
In the arid lap of the Himalayas, 16 years ago, a cult was born. The cult of the Raid de Himalaya. Forged of brotherhood, the thrill for seeking out adversity and thriving in it, and the love for motorsport, among other things. The raid that took place in 1999 was worlds apart from the Raid de Himalaya that we know today. From the kind of drivers to the danger quotient, from the regulations governing the event to the safety norms put in place.
So the Raid de Himalaya, as we all know, is now 16 years old. It's the 16th raid that we are running, right? The Raid de Himalaya, basically we started the Himalayan rally, right? And started somewhere in the 80s and went through till about 91 or something. And then it died its natural death. And somewhere, you know, I know my friend Vijay used to get very excited about the Paris-Dakar videos that he had, right? And somewhere in the back of his mind, he always knew that he's going to emulate Paris-Dakar in some way and do an event which will rival one of the toughest events in the world. And that's how the Raid de Himalaya was born.
You see, if we go right to 1999, if I take you, 1990 is when the Himalayan rally died. Let me start there. And then it was briefly filled in by an event called the Mountain Challenge, which sort of just ran in the Shivaliks and finished. Atul, Vijay and I, all three of us being from Simla, we'd often meet and, you know, casually say we should do an event. The prompting came from a very different source. The BJP took charge of the state, and Mr. Dhumal floated an idea, or not an idea, he sort of queried his secretary, youth services, that there used to be a very famous rally here. What happened to that, and why no motorsport? You know? And that gentleman knew Atul well, so Atul was called in, and so the club was formed all in a rush, and in a matter of no time we were out doing the recce here. So, you know, the push came from a very different source. The sort of urge to get into the sport was there, but casual at that point, you know. And then we got in, we started with a 4-day event, and then sort of during the course of that first event and the recce of the first event is when, you know, we started to encapsulate what should be, what shouldn't be, what length of stages, safety backups, etc. Everything started to take shape then, you know. And we've grown in or matured from our initial days when we were only hung up on 100 kilometer stages. So you're, you know, racing a lot of dangerous area or going into villages which needn't be. And then over a period of time, fine-tuned the whole thing into what we are today.
Well, if you look back in 1999 and you want to trace back the roots of the raid, we were much younger then, far more enthusiastic about the whole motorsport scene. And we got down to it with a far greater will than I think we have today. And a large part of it is, of course, the passage of 15 years, the aging of the original guard and things like that. But yeah, I think we did a great, you know, there was great progress between 1999 and 2001. It went up by leaps and bounds. And then it kind of plateaued around 2002. We couldn't really figure out how we were going to take it forward because the competitors were stuck at about 40, 45 and the raid was not going anywhere beyond that. So in 2003, I initiated the adventure trial as it was then, and we called it the reliability trial on its first run. And we introduced this as a category where an enthusiast could actually go there and learn rallying, because there are no rally schools in India. That probably accounts for the terrible driving standards. So 2003 saw a huge increase, not only in participation but in the type of people that would come for the raid. And now that particular category is slowly growing and growing, and what I feel today is that the more interesting category, the extreme, is actually on its way out.
The Raid de Himalaya is the highest rally raid in the world. You need to be a special breed of bonkers to rally in the inhospitable terrain and unpredictable weather of the Himalayas. The raid is known to break the uninitiated and the old hands alike. It pushes them to the limit, and then some more. Yet, year after year, the faithful return. Because they live by the old adage, what doesn't kill you, only makes you stronger.
I think it is the madness for motorsports. So that brings the officials back, that brings the volunteers, that brings the participants.
I would say that the people who are part of raid, they share a common, I would say, mentality which for other normal people would be like madness. Something which is totally illogical to face stupid conditions, extreme harsh terrain and physical punishment and still very happy to go next year.
I don't know why we keep coming back to this place, but I guess it's the aura of this raid, you know, which gets us back every year. Aura of this event, you know, no other event I feel in India has this kind of aura.
This is even tougher than any work that I've ever done in my life, right? This is the Himalaya, right? You're doing things which are different between life and death.
The 16th Raid de Himalaya began with the standard 2 days of technical scrutiny in Shimla. And then the ceremonial flag-off took place amidst the usual fanfare and camaraderie. A few hours of rest, and the real test would begin. The actual start of the raid this year was a little ahead of the dusty hamlet of Luri. The competitors took start with a sense of relief. Once word came in that the roughest and most scary stage of the day had been cancelled. It was a new addition to the raid's routes and was to run from the village of Kotlu to Katanda. So on day one, the raid extreme ran for 326 kilometers and had two competitive stages.
First day is you've got to be very careful. I mean, you know, coming to the raid, it's not a one-day event and it's not a race. It's a rally and it's the raid. So you have to be very conservative. You have to see. And the other thing with the gypsies is it's a catch-2 situation. Yeah, with the gypsies, that is the day to make time because that's your day. After that, these big engines are going to catch up with you. And that's the gypsy's day. So at the same time, pushing the gypsy and also trying to save the car, both at the same time. And my normally thought is, since the rally, the car has been so well prepared, money's been spent, so push it on the first. I mean, it should have been well prepared for that, to take up that beating. And let's see where one stands at the end of day one.
Defending champion Suresh Rana was amongst the fastest runners on day one. Aman Ahluwalia of Team Thunderbolt, Privateer Sanjay Agarwal and Lieutenant Colonel Shakti Bajaj of Team Army were keeping the pace. Amongst the bikers, Nick Sarau and Suresh Babu were amongst the fastest on day one.
As always in the raid, the first day is the toughest. And the surface was very, very rough. The first stage was rough. It didn't look rough in the recce, but when we actually did the stage, it was rather rough. And if we would have run the second stage, that would have been a big game changer. Like, trust me. We wouldn't have seen most of us here.
The raid did not fall short on drama on day one. Out of the 79 teams that took a start in Rally Extreme, 76 successfully made it to the end. Nishant Pal Yadav and Chirag Thakur of Team Tusker turned turtle in the middle of a competitive stage and ended their rally. Baljeet Singh of Chandigarh sustained a minor injury after falling from his bike and had to quit the raid too. Major Dankar and Major Ravi Dillon of Team Army Adventure had a radiator bust in their vehicle and bowed out. But this was only the beginning. The raid would not be happy about having to settle for just 3 scalps on day one. This would come back to haunt some people, and that too with interest.
Day one was pretty good. The second stage got cancelled, and that was where we had our doubts, because it was a very rough stage. So it was a relief for that stage to get cancelled. Stage 1 and stage 3, we pretty much just drove through, keeping in mind the incidents that we've had in previous years. And we wanted to make sure that we reach Manali safe and sound without any hiccups. All in all, it was pretty good. The stage was rough, no doubt. There was a little bit of slush, there was rough sections, so it was a mixed bag of pretty much everything.